brother.
God.
What's up?
This is a good recording, man.
Yeah,
I
brother,
can dig
like,
it.
Solid. Right on.
Brother, brother, there's far too many of you dying. Sam from the Queen of Queens segment. We are taking over the WHBR 33 channel today at the Family, Children's, and Justice Show. I also have with me Tiffany.
Hi.
So today we're going to talk about the ICE and immigration crisis. The Queen of Queens segment always speaks politics along with other issues that we have current day. And something that really touched both of our hearts is how families were separated recently. Our president.
Y'all's president.
You guys is president. Signed an order for to get immigrants out, illegal immigrants out, and then he also signed another order to kind of keep the families together and stop children from being separated from their families. They had them in like modern day concentration camps, and now they're going behind and basically redoing it. The living conditions were terrible. So would you like to speak on that a little bit?
Sure. So basically, my issue with the whole thing is, I'm not for illegal immigration at all, but I guess it's just the way they went about it, like separating the families and the kids, and then how do you lose 1,600 kids that are just, like, totally unaccounted for? Like, we don't know where they are. Mm-hmm. They're undocumented, and then the living conditions that they had to stay in. They were on the floor. They had these little, it looked like aluminum blankets. it was just atrocious.
Yes.
The way that they were living. And then you had people who were supporting it.
Right.
And were saying, well, the parents shouldn't have broke the law.
Right. So I think something that was very alarming to me that because they are immigrants and because they're not actual citizens of the United States, that they don't have any protections with us. So if they do,
but they're still people. They're still human beings.
Yeah. So I didn't like, they don't have any way to really find these kids, or actually, even if they say that it's 1,600 kids missing, is that an accurate number? Is it 2,000? Because these are kids that were kind of hidden, or even women. I know even on Indigenous peoples' reservations, women go missing all the time, and they have no accurate way of actually figuring out like who actually went missing. So who knows if these kids are in human trafficking circles, or are they deported? Did they go to the right area? They are literally taking these kids, or taking these people, just not even kids, when they're working. It's like a drug raid when they come in and ICE comes in and take those people. And it's pretty traumatizing.
Definitely. I was traumatized from looking at the pictures.
Yeah. I could only imagine, like, how are you feeding them? What are you feeding them? How are you speaking to them? And things of that nature. We actually live very close to a border, and we don't even have those issues here in Michigan. So,
well, it's not a lot of Canadians trying to.
Right, they don't want to come over here. But we became a sanctuary city along with other cities. I know Baltimore, Atlanta were sanctuary cities where basically people were safe, like the mayor like signed before. The president actually signed his form or his executive order. A couple mayors and governors signed different forms like, we cannot have you just separating people like that. We don't participate in this. We're good. This is not going to continue to go on. So I think that was ideal. I agree with that.
We did that here?
We didn't do that exactly. We were already a sanctuary city because we have a lot of immigrants coming in. Okay. It's just so close to a border. We don't really, basically, we're not really against immigrants as much. But, like, certain places that's also close to borders, like Texas, weren't doing that same thing. Like, Texas is very close to Mexico.
Right.
And they weren't doing that thing. They were 100% participating in
deporting it. Yeah, I could imagine Texas being totally against immigration.
Yes. One thing that I also thought was very interesting is the time that it took for us to kind of recall the law. And a lot of people were saying, oh, this is the un-American way. Do you feel like it's the un-American way that we actually were splitting up families?
Absolutely not. I feel like America has been splitting up families since slavery.
Before slavery. They were splitting up families when the indigenous people were here.
Correct. So I feel like that's what this country was built on. Yeah. Was tearing apart families. And it's sad. I mean, it's been going on for so long. Even the the welfare system where the man can't be in the household. Mm-hmm. For the woman to receive benefits, or the mass incarceration of black men, it's all a way to tear apart families. So I definitely think that's the American thing to do.
Do you feel like it was different because of the media this time, or like why do you think like it was such an outrage?
I definitely think social media played a part in it. Being able to see the actual conditions, and then the fact that it was actual concentration camps. Uh-huh. So, like, with the black families, it's a way for certain people to still try to blame it on us. Like, we weren't, doing what we're supposed to be doing. He's a criminal. He's a thug. Uh-huh. But with this, it's more like you can't really deny the fact that these children were totally innocent and they're being taken away from their families and held in these camps. But what I did find on social media, it was still people on there who were supporting the tearing apart of these families. And they were saying, like, these kids, they're being educated in these camps, and they're playing PlayStation. They're sitting around all day, like they in a high-end hotel.
Yeah, no, that's exactly not what I seen.
Yeah,
I think that like they had the worst living arrangements possible. Even when most of the immigrants come here and they work either legally or illegally, they work in migrant farms or labor camps. And those living conditions are terrible. We actually have in Michigan, we do have like,
ready to work. Is it called ready to work?
No, so because we have so much greenage crops and stuff like that, people actually work on the farms. Our living conditions are a little bit better. They have like trailer parks that the migrant farm workers can work in, but a lot of other places like California, where they have like Napa Valley with the wine and like the lettuce and like tomatoes and stuff like that, they have like really bad work conditions. Like I want to say 1 in 4 women are raped on those on those farms, and it's always eye opening to me that it's certain people that we kind of turn a blind eye to, minority people in general. Like we went back through history, like, okay, well, the indigenous people were like moved and killed and raped and gave diseases. And then after that, they had like slavery. And then after that, they had like the Japanese internment camps. Like they had actual concentration camps here too. But because the Japanese were so cooperative with the U.S. government, that it didn't actually wasn't that bad, I guess. Like people were like, oh, well, they're okay with it. So, I mean, how can we get mad if they're not outraged? I think that because this time it's like, whoa, it's 2018, you're a developed country. Why are you imprisoning people? Like, and just keeping them hostage. It's better ways to go about that. I think just in general, globally, people like were looking down upon us. Like, you're totally not handling this right.
Right. And I think that's why it's so important to study history so that you keep it from repeating itself over and over.
And history always repeats itself.
Yeah. And I always used to wonder, like, how people allowed that stuff to go on mm-hmm. when it was actually going on. But now you can see it.
Right.
In this day and age, you can see how people are so removed mm-hmm. from humanity, basically.
Yeah.
Like,
I think if it's not directly affecting you, it's hard for you to emphasize with it. And I think that a lot of people don't understand that. When it's not like, because like we knew it was like an immigrant problem, and it was like, it was a lot of build up to this. Like Trump won on immigration, you know, like his forum. Like, I want to get all these people out of here. These people are stealing your jobs. They can't even legally work, so how are they stealing your jobs?
First of all, most of those jobs are jobs we don't even want, first of all. let's be perfectly honest about that.
Yeah, you know, and they work, like, 10-hour days for, like, $40.
Yeah, probably more than that. 12-hour days, 16-hour shifts. And then Trump, he built so many of his businesses on immigrant labor. It's
right.
ridiculous that he would be the one that's now totally against it.
His wife is an immigrant.
Hello? Right. He bought a whole immigrant over here.
I always hit my face on the way. But, so, the whole, I think that it was a scare. So, like, any other thing that they bring up, net neutrality, anything, like, that they bring up, it becomes a scare, and then we feel like we need to hurry up and do something about it. And it just, it's terrible that it happened to be a group of people that we felt like we needed to remove so aggressively and harshly.
Right.
And when I, like, I just, I guess because I, maybe it's because I grew up, like, near Southwest, and I worked in Southwest for a long time when I was like a teenager, that like I heard different like horror stories mm-hmm. and from there I just like I emphasized with it because it directly affect me. Now if maybe if I didn't, you know, have it, maybe I wouldn't be so passionate about it, but mm-hmm. I don't think that I would be for it. But I just think like maybe it's because it affected me directly when I hear stories about like my a girl who I know that's my age, and she's like, my mom is trying to get over here with me. They took her in the middle of the night. So that's why it's like, I guess because I can put a face to a story, I emphasize with it a little bit more.
I mean, I don't, it doesn't affect me at all. It doesn't. But just the fact that I'm a human being, I mean, I can empathize with what's going on. I don't have to personally have a connection to it to see that it's a problem, and I feel like that's what people should be able to do.
They should. I definitely agree.
You should be able to put yourself in somebody else's shoes, even if you're not going through it personally or it's not personally affecting you in any type of way.
I think it's just a little, I think you should, but I think like it's just a little harder. Like I think that a lot of people don't have that. Like, because, like, maybe it's because, and you might not directly see it, but maybe it's because, you know, you are black and you feel like they separated black people all this time. So now when you see the brown people, you're like, whoo, like, this hits close to home. It might be indirect.
You think so? I don't know.
Now you have to go home and think about it.
Right. I gotta go reflect on my life now.
So, speaking of the immigration thing, our wonderful first lady went to go meet the kids that were separated from their families. And she had a jacket on to say, I don't care, do you? I think that's what it said.
Yep, that's exactly what it said.
So how do you feel about that?
I thought it was, the jacket itself I thought was actually nice.
I like the jacket a lot.
I like the jacket.
I would buy that. But I would definitely have it. But it would I probably wouldn't wear it to something like
absolutely
that.
Absolutely not. I think that was very poor taste.
And doesn't she have a staff to like, it should be like a PR person, somebody that stops her from wearing stuff like that. Like, she's like 40. She got to be 40, maybe 50. I don't think a 40 or 50 year old should wear a jacket like that.
I don't know.
I wouldn't want to see my mom in a jacket like that. As a first lady.
Right.
As a regular human being, like a college student or like, I think that's different.
Yeah. Yeah, I just think it was definitely within poor taste to wear that when you're meeting immigrant children.
Yeah, and it's like, I really don't care. I'm rich. I'm sitting in my Caucasian mansion. Right.
Do you care? And then for them to try to flip it and act like she was talking about the news, the media, like she was sick of them spreading lies, so she was over it. It was just sad.
Yes.
All right. Well, we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we'll introduce you to our guests. Thank you. Stay tuned.
Hey, what's happening?
Brother, what's up? This
is a pubic party, man.
Yeah, brother, dig it. Stop. Right on.
And we're back, and we are with the owner of Black Out Loud Teas, Miss Deandra.
How you doing today?
Hi, Deandra. It's so nice to have you.
Thank you for having me.
No problem at all. Can you tell us a little bit about Black Out Teas?
Well, I wanted to change the narrative and the design of what we wear and what we showcase. I don't want to always see custom-made designs and rest in peace. I don't want to have a shirt with my face on it or with my loved one's face on it, and it's in remembrance. Right. I want to give my flowers to my family while they're here. So I decided to start designing and making active and expressive wear, where you can actually feel where I'm coming from, feel the design. It's speaking for itself. That's why I said Black Out Loud, because my designs are loud enough to be heard. If I walk down the street, you're going to know that I'm proud of my heritage. I'm proud of my background. I'm just proud. You know, these are my grandparents. This is one of my designs, Black Love. They've been married for 51 years.
Oh my
I don't
God.
Want to say rest in peace Black love. No, right, this is a living, breathing love.
Yeah.
So that's where it all just stemmed from, wanting to just get out that whole stigma of anytime we have a design on our back that's from our own, it's because we're celebrating the life that was lost. Ooh. You know.
I really like that.
I like that a lot.
Yeah,
I like that a lot.
I really like that.
Thank you.
How long have you been in business?
So I launched last year in November.
Oh,
so
wow.
This is my first year doing it, and I'm just learning as I go. You know, I've got a lot of opportunities. The city will support you, and that's where I'm getting so much love and so much just that push to go ahead, even when I, you know, have maybe stumbled or things may not go as well, I still have the support from the city, and so that's driving me, my driving force.
Absolutely.
So is this like, do you have a next step after this, or like what's your next goals with the clothing line?
Well, right now I'm doing my website, mm-hmm. blackoutloudtees.com.
Mm-hmm.
And my next step would be a brick and mortar store.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my biggest goal. That's my next goal. Because I do a lot of custom cutting work, whether it's putting the fancy little holes in the tops,
mm-hmm.
or turning them to crop tops.
Mm-hmm.
So I need a space for that.
Okay.
If someone wanted it customized, whether with holes or with lace or with leather, my next goal would be to have a brick and mortar store.
That's awesome. So right now, if someone wanted to order your clothing, it would be done online, or?
Yes.
Okay.
So they would go to my website, blackoutloudtees.com. Even if they wanted a customized shirt, even if they scrolled down and say, well, hey, I want something different. I want a picture with my grandparents or my parents on it, or me and my boyfriend, or Baywatch, or whatever.
Right.
You know, they can go on my website and I'll design them. I do all of my designs myself. They're all custom made.
Awesome.
I think that's so interesting.
Thank you.
Absolutely. So what challenges have you faced so far with the business?
you know, it's been a lot. I didn't know the t-shirt game was more of a male run game.
Mostly everything.
So just trying to find that mentor. It was a lot. I ate a lot of cost. The ink might not have been as vibrant as I thought. The words came out small instead of big. In the beginning, I ate so many costs. But, you know, you learn as you go. You network with people, and you learn from it. You know, right. I could have gave up at the first big loss I had. I was, you know, I decided to launch this during a period of time where I was laid off from my job. And so I took all of my savings to put into my website, to put into my designs, to put into myself and my dream. And within that first 3 months, I was broke. I was like, okay, yeah, this is not it. And one of my friends told me, said, you're right on track. She was like, that's how all the good dreams start, when you hear somebody say they put in their last and they had no money. I said, nah, that's not it. But, you know, like I said, family support, support from social, just strangers. I'll wear my t-shirt just to the gas station or anywhere, and they say, well, you know, how do I get one? And just that support just kept me going, like, okay, I could do this. I can really, you know, do more.
Absolutely.
So do you ever feel like you're discriminated against because you're a woman?
Oh, yes. 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 I think, you know, I've ran into some people that just didn't take me serious. You know, like, you got a t-shirt line, really?
Right. Should you be at home?
Yes. Like, yes, I'm for real. What type of regular tees,
right?
You know, I'm not, it's not a, no, I don't have a swimsuit line. No, I don't have
right.
a lip makeup gloss. Line.
Right.
Yeah, I have t-shirts for men and women.
Right.
You know, and a lot of people just don't understand that. Or like I said, I'm just really finding out that it's a boy's game. And so just trying to break into it. It has been some setbacks and it has been hard, but it's all about persevering. You got to always persevere.
Absolutely.
You want to know what? I heard this quote like a week ago, and it made so much sense. It said, the higher you go up in success, the less you see women. And even if
and
you
blacks.
Get... so black women are like a unicorn.
Right.
So you have to keep going, even if it's not for yourself, because somebody else could look up to you and say, like, wow, she did it, so I can. And we didn't really have those people to look up to, like our parents or things of that nature, our mothers and stuff like that. We're homemakers, so we're kind of, this generation is kind of like breaking the barriers right now. So I would definitely keep going. I think that's so awesome.
Absolutely. What bit of advice would you give to other black women that are looking to break into this industry?
Do your research. You know, it's sort of like, you know, how you'll go on YouTube and you'll see a video and you say, oh, I could do that. And you don't nail it.
Yeah.
You don't
nail it. Me with my twist tops.
Right. And that's how I felt. I felt like I seen all these great Detroit brands, and I didn't take the time to appreciate their struggle. I didn't take the time to appreciate actually, even if it's only on the website, a website business is still a business.
Absolutely.
So I didn't do enough research, and that's why, you know, I had to eat so many costs in the beginning. But I would say do your research and have a support system. Mm. Have a support system that's not going to let you quit, because you're going to run into some issues. You're going to run into setbacks. But if you have that support system to say, okay, I'm going to give you 5 minutes to cry. After these 5 minutes, you're going to get back to work. And that's what just kept me going, is I'll have my days of frustration where, you know, I might sit around and design a shirt for 2.5-3 hours, and the order, they don't pay me. I've been stiffed already, or things of that nature. So you have to just keep going and rolling with the punches, and you'll eventually get there.
Awesome. Well, I appreciate you for coming on the show It was so nice meeting you. Just give us your social media again and your website.
Well, so Instagram is Blackout Loud Tees. My website is blackoutloudtees.com. And on Facebook, I just go by my regular name, Deandra Tanae.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, that is all we have for you guys today. Thank you for joining us as we take over the family justice.
Children's justice.
Children's justice show. She has with Debbie Allen. Yes. It's been a long day. Do you want to give out our social media, ma'am?
I'll try. So we have Instagram is queen to queen 2 underscores. Yes. Twitter is queen to queen. And then our Facebook is also queen to queen. No underscores, right?
Correct.
No underscores. Again, my name is Roxanne. This is Tiffany.
And this is Deandra.
And thank you guys for watching us. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel as well. And that's queen to queen. Just regular. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.
Hey, what's up now?
Brother, what's up?
This is a groovy party, man. Yeah, I can dig it.
Stop right on.
Hey, man, what's up?